Yes, thank you very much. Can you hear me? Okay, thank you for inviting me and giving me the opportunity to tell you about non-sedation experimental or routine. In our department, it has been a routine for the last 17 years, and we have the opinion that you should only sedate patients if there is a medical reason for the sedation. It could be a hypothermia after cardiac arrest or something like that. I show you some pictures, and all the patients has allowed me to show these pictures of them. Conflict of interest, we have none because we're not selling a drug. In contrast, we're trying to learn you not to use drugs if it is not necessary. It's a very good picture, after my opinion. You see the patient here, orally intubated, and an oral tube is not a reason for sedation. You have the relatives over here. He's able to have contact with his relatives. And you have the nurse over here. There's a nurse-to-patient ratio of 1:1. So each patient has his, personal nurse, who's also always within reach, so he feels secure that there's somebody who can help him. Well, for the last 17 years, there have been, a worldwide trend towards less sedation. We published for the first time a scientific article about it in 2010, but there were works in the United States who started this trend. There was this by Tracy Bell from Chicago, and they introduced a daily interruption of sedation and was able to show that with a daily interruption of sedation, the patient stayed for a shorter time in the ventilator and a shorter time in the ICU. Then came this study, combined also from the United States. It was from Chicago and from Nashville, where they used the time where they performed the daily interruption of sedation. They used that period of time to work with the patient. They tried to wean the patient from the ventilator actively during the time when the patient was awake. And they were able to show that the time on the ventilator was shorter, the time in the ICU and in the hospital was shorter, and even the mortality after 1 year was significantly reduced in the group with the daily interruption and the active weaning during the time when the patient were awake. Then some years ago came this study from Canada and the United States by Mesa et al. They wanted to show that if they used a sedation scale and scored the patient every hour, it was they could obtain the same results as with a daily interruption of sedation. And as you can see, there was no difference between the two groups, but there's some concern about this study. You have to have a patient to nurse ratio 1:1, the same with our non-SEDA study. The complicated patient were excluded, only benzodiazepine was used, and they had a rather broad sedation score, a scale from 0 to -3. I'll show you later how deeply the patients actually were sedated in this study. In nearly 80% of the patients, restraint was used. This is amazing. What is a restraint? It means that they tied the patients. So outside Scandinavia, it's common practice not only to sedate the patients, but to tie them up. In 80% in the United States and Canada, after my opinion, it's amazing. They performed the daily wake-up trial in only 72% of the patients, and larger doses of sedation was used in the group with the daily interruption. It ought to be the other way around. Mesa, their take-home message was that if you scored the sedation level very often, you could avoid too deep a level of sedation. And I would say my take-home message is that the danger is over-sedation, and you should avoid that. And if you wake up the patients and let them stay awake, then you avoid too deep levels of sedation. And we performed a single-center study in 2010, or we published it in 2010. It was a single-center study in Odense University Hospital. It was published in Lancet, and we could see a significantly shorter time on the ventilator in the non-SEDA group And we compared to the golden standard, the United States golden standard, which is light sedation and a daily interruption of sedation. So let's say a Scandinavian or Danish way of doing it compared to the American way. But the non-sedar patient stayed for a shorter time in the ventilator. They also have a significantly shorter time in the ICU, 13 days as compared to 22 days, and a significantly shorter hospital stay. And they even have a tendency towards a lower mortality. The mortality, the difference was not significant, and it was not a primary goal, but the p-value was 0.06, which means nearly significant reduction in mortality. This is the level of sedation in our control group. You see they're only lightly sedated. And below you have the sedation level in the study by Mesa et al. And you see they are rather heavily sedated. They are heavily sedated. I have read in some articles, and I also heard at different congresses, my colleagues say that the only reason we could find a significant benefit for non-sedation was that our control group was deeply sedated. It's actually not true. As you can see, our control group is very lightly sedated, and then we had daily interruption of sedation. Okay, if a wake-up trial is beneficial, a sedation holiday, why not prolong the holiday? And it is a continuous sedation holiday, or the non-sedar study, which we nearly have finished. We plan to include 700 patients in 8 centers in Scandinavia, and we choose 8 centers to be able to control the treatment of the patient, because it is not a drug, it's a change of culture. And why 700 patients? You see, this is the results from our single center study. As you can see, the mortality, it's not significantly, but nearly significantly reduced in the non-sedation group. It was not a priori goal or target, the mortality. But if these data, they are true, if they are true, then we'll be able to show a reduction in mortality by including 700 patients. Our goal was that, primary goal was a reduction in 90 days mortality. And then we have several other goals, reduction in hospital length of stay, reduction in ICU length of stay, days without the ventilator, and days without delirium. We also made a sub-study by one of our PhD students, Helene, with 200 patients. We investigated their physical strength, because our hypothesis is that patients who can move around and are not sedated, they have more muscles or less muscle wasting. And we hope to find a better cognitive function in the non-sedated patients and not an increased incidence of post-traumatic stress disorder. We have a rather good economy supported by the Danish Council of Strategic Research and also by SSAI. So we could pay 3,000 Danish kroner for each patient included, and we could afford for a study nurse for nearly 2 years, 50% of the time she should spend including patients into the study. But again, it's a change of culture. It's not a drug we give the patient. So our message is that you should treat the patient according to the patient's need and not according to the need of the department. Provide analgesia before you sedate the patients, and sedation should be the last way out. We should have a nurse-to-patient ratio 1-to-1. We have that in most the university hospitals in Denmark, in the other part of Scandinavia, also in Australia and New Zealand, and some parts of the United States. Well, we were able to show a benefit in a single-center study in Odense, where we used to non-sedation. And it's a homogeneous treatment and local expertise. But you know, it's been difficult to extrapolate the results from single-center studies to multi-center studies. That's what we're trying to do now. Despite a common protocol, there's also always some deviation between the different centers. And the beneficial result might disappear due to this noise. We're a little bit afraid of a Hawthorne effect, which means that you treat the control group better than the other patients because they are part of a scientific study. only ACE centers because we were able to control the treatment, which is a change in culture. Okay, this is the group when we started, very optimistic. We plan to include 700 patients within 3 years, and this is how it went. We started to one center at a time to be sure that we could control the treatment. As this line, all the centers are including patients, and what's happening up here? We ran out of study nurses. The negative way is that I'm a little bit surprised that doctors are not able to include patients if you don't have a study nurse. On the other way, you could interpret it in a positive way and say that non-sedation is a question about cooperation between doctors and nurses. If the nurses are not agree with you in the non-sedation, you cannot perform it. So we have both groups have to be want the sedation way of treating the patients. This is the centers, and you see we need 20 more patients than we have finished. I hope they include one while I'm here. So I have not very much strong data to give you. We have some data. Non-sedation can be implemented. We've shown that in different centers. There's few adverse events because we have to report them. One of the adverse events was accidental extubation, where the patient needed reintubation within 1 hour. There were 4 patients in the non-sedation group and 1 in the sedation group, none in Odense. We were able to study the sleep pattern because the patients were non-sedated, and Julia, one of our PhD students, could show that patients who are not sedated have abnormal sleep pattern. And Helene, another PhD student, showed that there was a tendency towards less pressure ulcers in the non-sedated group. We have looked at all the non-sedated patients with ARDS, and we found we have a comparable mortality or survival with other centers with patients with severe ARDS. Our patients are treated with non-sedation, many of them are mobilized, and on a pressure support because they can trigger the ventilator. Our experience is that if you sedate these patients, they do not oxygenate better and are not easier to ventilate them. Often, in contrast, it gets worse. So if we sedate our patients with severe ARDS, we sedate them because we want to put them in the prone position. Not sedation for sedation, but sedation to put them in the prone position. Okay. Then there was a scandal, or what you call it, in Denmark last year. The labor inspectorate visited an ICU in a hospital in Denmark, and they found out that they sedated the patients because they had lack of nurses. So when they sedated the patients, one nurse could take care of 2 patients. And in some way, the Minister of Health, she heard about it, and she said it was totally unacceptable to sedate the patients. It was insane. It had to be stopped immediately. The chairman of the nurses in Denmark, she said it was a sick culture to sedate the patients. I don't know what you think, but that is what happened. Then I have a case. We included a patient, and he was randomized to non-sedation in a central hospital. Then he was awake and comfortable in the ventilator, transferred to a university hospital for second opinion. When the patient arrived, they were horrified. The patient was awake. They could communicate with the patient, and he was awake. So immediately, he was deeply sedated. And he was sedated until he returned to the central hospital next day. Then they stopped the sedation and woke up the patient, who again was awake and comfortable. So it raises the question, are you allowed to sedate patients without informed consent? I don't know what your opinion about it. The main difference between sedated patient and non-sedated patient is that they are able to communicate. You have a human being who is alive and communicate. She can write her opinion about the treatment and what she wants to the staff, to the nurses, and to the doctors. She can eat an ice cream. She can have visit from her relatives during her ICU stay. And again, communication. That's the big difference. You have an alive patient who can communicate. I'll say if you want to visit us, you're very welcome. And maybe you should bring a nurse because it's a cooperation between doctors and nurses if you want to perform this way of treating the patient. Next month, we actually have a visit from the editor of New England Journal of Medicine. He's in Denmark, and he was asked what he wanted to see. And he said, if not the Little Mermaid, he said, no, he wants to see this Nonsedation in Odense. So he'll visit us next month. He's welcome, of course. Again, the take-home message is that treat the patient according to the patient's need and not to the need of the department. Provide sufficient analgesia for the patient before you sedate the patient. And if the patient can't tolerate being without sedation, then it is the last way out. But in the case of sedation, you use a sedation scale, and the next day you wake a wake-up trial. Because if the patient can't tolerate sedation today, he might tolerate to be without sedation the next day. And non-sedation can be implemented. It's not dangerous. There's actually few adverse events. And here's the patient with ARDS, 85% oxygen, and 26 in PEEP. And thank you for staying awake, and thank you for listening.
Thank you, Palle, for a very interesting lecture. This is something I think is very important, and at least in Sweden, where I'm quite sure we over-sedate quite often, and I think the results of the study will have quite an impact on what we do in Sweden as well. Do we have any quick questions from the audience? I have a question. You mentioned that one of the things you're going to look at is post-traumatic stress disorder. Do you have any insights of previous studies? Because that's one of the worries, at least in Sweden, that these patients that aren't sedated will have a lot of problems with later stress disorder issues. Are there any studies, any results from earlier studies about this?
About delirium or?
And about later effects, how the patients do.
I would say all the studies which have been done until now, including our first study, there's been a tendency that being awake actually protects the patient against psychological adverse events later on. So there's some kind of protection of being awake. The American studies have investigated that. And we perform we put on a neuropsychologist to investigate 200 patients in our subgroup. All the survivors will be investigated with a neuropsychologist. Takes several hours to find out the psychological side effects. And we did not do it in our first study, but in this study we're actually scoring the patient for delirium two times a day throughout the study. So I'll give you some answers within a couple of months.
Perfect. Look forward to it. Thank you very much, Paul.
Thank you.